Good morning. Thank you for joining us for Family Time Devotion. It's Wednesday, July 15th. Today we're going to continue our discussion on race with Jermichael and Zach. And thank you so much for tuning in.
So this morning, I was just scrolling through Facebook and I seen this article and the caption that someone reposted, they said, "What's wrong with this picture?" Well, matter of fact, I'll show it to you first and you tell me if you recognize what's wrong with it. If you can, don't say what it is before I show Zach. Do you think you got it, or? Okay. Can you explain to them what you just saw?
So basically, it was a burglary, and it looks like a black gentleman committed a crime.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and so on that side, there's another article about a homicide suspect.
Right. So you said what you saw was an article where there was a black guy, because it's his picture, mm-hmm. big picture, and then in big bold letters it says, burglary suspect caught, in the middle of the paper. And then on a small side on the left, there's a small picture of a white guy that says suspect who killed two people, two homicides, has been arrested. All sin is sin. But which crime deserved to be on the front page of the paper? Was it the burglar, or was it the one who killed two people? Mm. Why is that story minimized, right, but the one who was a theft is magnified? And so that goes into the training and the psyche of those who become biased, right? Because it's what's constantly pushed on us, a certain narrative about a certain group of people. When the truth is, we're all the same, we all commit the same type of sins, but why does one demonize more than the other? And I think that's the weight that I carry as a black man every day. I don't care how small it is, that weight is going to come down on me harder than it would a white gentleman or a white female. And that's what white privilege is. And I think that's the word that we talked about where we said it makes a lot of people uncomfortable. And I think the word white privilege makes people uncomfortable initially because, first of all, you have to talk about what it isn't before you address what it is. And I think when people think of white privilege, they hear it and they say, well, I haven't been privileged. I had to work my whole life. I had to pull myself up by my own bootstraps. I had to do this, I had to do that. That's not what white privilege is. White privilege is being able to walk out your front door, plan out your day, and know that at the end of the day, you're gonna come home because you've done what you were supposed to do. Not having black privilege or not having white privilege literally means that I make the same plans for my day, but I have to realize that at a certain time, I better not be in this neighborhood. I better make sure that I'm not wearing this outfit. I don't have on a hoodie. I make sure that I'm in a place where it's well lit, people can see me, and then I have to be polite to everyone that I meet, even if I'm having a bad day, because I don't know who is who, who's connected, and what they could do to me in this area. That's the difference. Mm. I said a lot. But I don't. Hopefully, I answered your question.
That's good. I'm glad you. That picture right there is a great example. I right. Appreciate you sharing that as well. Yeah.
I was going to ask you, Zach, and then Jermichael, you can join in too. I mean, why should the church? Let's talk about the church. Why should the church care about race and racial injustice?
I think a better question would be, why shouldn't they? I think the question, I hear your question, but I think the question, if you're a Christian, why shouldn't you care about people being treated fairly, anybody? Why shouldn't people, seeing people being mistreated, being killed on camera, why is that okay? Why is that not something that you as a Christian should be speaking up about? Why is that, why is there a but mm-hmm. with that, right? If the Bible tells us that we should love our neighbors as we love ourselves. So if you see a neighbor that is not being treated like you would treat yourself, why wouldn't you worry about that? And I think that's the part that concerns me, because we even have to ask that question, right?
Yeah, that's a great point. Why we even have to ask that question? And even looking at it from a biblical perspective, you've just been going through the series on Acts and mm-hmm. how Peter went to Cornelius and how that he had to address his own sin of partiality, his own sin. And you look at how in Galatians 2, how Paul had to call him out on that sin.
Yeah.
Paul recognized that sin of partiality, that sin of really racism. You look at Jesus and the band of disciples that he called together that were from all over. You had a zealot who hated the Roman Empire, and then you had Matthew, the tax collector, who worked for the Roman Empire, and you just had all these different people that came together. You can just imagine what that the fights that would have happened in right. there that Jesus would have worked through over those 3 years that they were together. And so there was all kinds of the whole New Testament is all about Jesus calling people to be together as one. John 17, his last prayer, mm-hmm. is about that you would be one. And so this is definitely something the church should be fighting for.
And you are absolutely correct. One of the examples that I love to use, why it's important that we call these things out, why it's important that we have these conversations. If you remember when Jesus was ministering to the lady who was caught in the act, right? One of the things that has frustrated me about evangelical Christians at this point, they're saying we see that the people are being mistreated. We see the murder of George Floyd. We see that the murderers for Breonna Taylor have not been. We see all of that, but can't we just talk about Jesus? Can't we just love one another? We absolutely can. Matter of fact, I believe Rodney King asked us, "Can't we all just get along?" in 1990, but here we are, 2020, having this conversation. But what I remember about Jesus when he was talking to he was with the lady who was caught in the act. There were a group of men with stones in their hands, and they were getting ready to stone her and kill her. The Bible says that Jesus went and he wrote something in the dirt, right? He didn't speak, but what he did was whatever he wrote in the dirt, we don't know what it is, but whatever it was, it convicted them to the point to where they dropped their stones and they turned away. What am I trying to say? He didn't start quoting scripture. He didn't start doing this. He simply wrote something that pricked each man's heart. And I just believe, that maybe he showed them their sin that caused them to believe, well, she's not as bad as we are in certain areas. Like, maybe we should have grace. Maybe we should show mercy. And so they dropped their stones. And so I believe by us having these conversations, we're doing what Jesus did. We're calling certain things out to make people see themselves in the situation that hopefully will prick the heart enough to say, maybe I should look at this a different way.
Mm. That's using that same passage. Brian Stevenson, the author of Just Mercy and director of Equal Justice Initiative, uses that passage to say that God calls us all as Christians to be stone catchers, that we need to stand in the gap for those who are in unjust situations.
Right.
And we need to be stone catchers. And I love that illustration.
That's good. Hmm.
Do you feel like from your viewpoint, the church is doing a good job as a whole addressing the issue of race? And then let me say it, a two-part. You're a third-generation
right.
pastor. Are you seeing improvements?
Let me say that Miles Strait is doing an amazing job. The fact that you are having this conversation, the fact that your members are watching this right now, shows me just how progressive you guys are and really want to have Christian hearts about this. But what your question was, do you think that the church has done a great job with racial reconciliation, all that? Yes and no. Yet more along to the no
okay.
than the yes. And the reason I say that is because you mentioned my grandfather. My grandfather grew up during a time doing Jim Crow. He grew up during a time where we did not have certain rights. We were not equal. And I remember hearing the stories, and I'm a big history buff. So I'm a Martin Luther King, civil rights student. I watched this research. I've been like that my whole life. But I remember the church coming together during that time, black and white, to say, this is not the Christian way, this is not right, and they were fighting for equal justice for a group of people who were experiencing injustice. But then I also remember that Martin Luther King wrote a letter from the Birmingham jail where they were saying, well, you got certain rights now. Can we just wait? You're pushing too hard to get everything done at the same time. And Martin Luther King replied, he said, how long should we wait? We've been waiting 400 years. If now is not the time, then when is the time? And so in 1960, they're saying, can't we just wait? But now we're in 2020. Did we wait too long? What would happen if we didn't start? Have we started at all? Because if we did, we wouldn't be here today. And so I am a little, I'm always hopeful, but I also believe that the church has not done a great job as a whole when it comes to race and relationships, because we're having this conversation today.
Help us here. Give us some practical ways that our congregation is primarily, you know, almost a whole white people.
Okay.
How can we, what can we do to, that would bring healing and make steps towards reconciliation?
Well, this is the first step. I believe having conversation is the first step. I do believe that, and I understand that a lot of us sometimes, we may not individually feel these things, but the people we have, family members, we have people that we grew up with, we have coworkers, people we love dearly, who may not feel the same way what we feel when we talk about justice and people needing equal rights. And so I think that the biggest thing that we all can do, and not just white people, but this is everybody, whenever you see something that is not right, speak up. We said this before. We were watching something, and this guy was getting ready to do a march, and he's like, how many of y'all are ready to get? They were actually marching with the black people. They were saying, how many are you ready to give up your white privilege? And everybody's like, yeah. And then somebody from the back comes and says, no, don't do that. Use that. We need that. We need your voice. Whatever level of influence that you have, speak up. Use your Facebook pages. Use your outings when you're with your family, you're with your friends. Try to help others see that maybe being prejudiced and having biases isn't the right way. I think we should speak up, and then I should believe that we should try to help and stand with our brothers and sisters when they're fighting for their rights, whether it be in the school system, because we know that sometimes the educational system is not always equal. We have those who go to private schools that have great things, and then we have those who are in the inner city that struggle to have textbooks. So when we're having these public hearings, we're having these meetings, attend those. Speak up and say, well, this isn't right. Otherwise, it just looks like a group of people who are angry, and we're not angry. We just want the same things that you have, the same opportunities. And so speak up and utilize every resource that you have to help further the discussion.
That's good. That's really good. You know, and I think kind of this question kind of goes along with that, but the thing I want to try to bring awareness to is maybe blind spots that we just don't see as because we're not forced to see, you know, we choose not to see. But what would be some blind spots, maybe not just for white people, but for all races that we need to bring awareness to?
There are several blind spots. Like you said, there's not just white people, everybody has. I think historically, history is a blind spot sometimes. I think it's good. They always say you don't know where you're going unless you know where you've been. And I think that's great. But I also think that sometimes we can use history as a crutch and a handicap to keep us from improving. And so I think history can be a blind spot, being stuck there, not wanting to advance, not wanting to move forward. And then there are certain biases. I think a major blind spot that I've even started to see as I've started becoming an adult, have a family, starting to try to buy homes and things like that, is systematic racism. There are certain things that I have to fight against all of the time. And then when I'll talk to my white friends, a lot of times there was, well, it's easy. Just do this, do that, do that. And I'm saying, well, I don't know how to do that. Why? Because I was never taught that. I don't understand that. I was talking to a friend the other day. I asked, if you got in trouble tomorrow, do you have a lawyer? He said, yeah, my dad got, like, he has like two different lawyers. They're all part of the family. And so I'm thinking, if I got in trouble, or if someone I know that looks like me got in trouble, we don't know lawyers. We have to rely on a public defender who most of the time doesn't know our name. And if he does know our name, he doesn't care enough to fight for us. So there are certain things and privileges and certain resources that are out there that are accessible to other races a little bit more easier than it is for the African American. And so I think sometimes we forget that, and we think that Well, it's just as easy. I was able to do it. I think one of the greatest analogies Dr. King used back in the day, he said, there were a lot of white people would say, well, I did this, I did that, I had to work hard, I went to school, got a good education, da da da. Well, I had to pull my own self up by my own bootstraps. Well, that's easy to do when you got boots. But if you don't have boots, you don't have shoestring, how do you pull yourself up? And so I think the blind spot sometimes is that we can lose empathy at the sake of our own experience. And so I think the lack of empathy is a major blind spot.
Go ahead, Jack.
And the word empathy is a great word. I think no matter where we are in life, having the right posture of empathy of, you said it earlier, our coworkers, family, whoever it is, to be able to say, how can I put myself in your shoes? When we were at that lunch, there was another youth pastor who did some Uber driving on the side. And he said, you know, whenever I have someone who's African-American in my car, I'm just going to ask them what their story is. Yeah. Have they encountered racism? And just because I want to put myself in their shoes. And he said, at that point, I think he said he had had seven different ones. He said, not a single person turned me down on the opportunity to share. Yeah. And I think that is, I think we're, like you said, we have this, Mickey, you said we have this disconnect where sometimes we want to kind of stay in our room, our shelter, our space. And I think that we don't want to get out of it. But if we can have the posture, say, okay, please share with me your story. Tell me what your life has been like. And I can tell you what my life has been like. And so we can get to know what it's like to be in each other's shoes.
Intentionality. Be intentional. Have those conversations. I was talking, I met with Chris the other day, right? So Chris is now my buddy, man. I tell you, we talk all the time. I met Chris like a month ago. But I love Chris because we share so many things that we have in common. He's just easy to talk to. But it did not come before he said, man, I had to get over my nervousness not to just even ask you certain questions. But after he asked those questions, I'm like, dude, just ask. How are you ever going to learn if you don't ask? And so I feel like sometimes we walk around in our own ignorance because we refuse to take the step or risk asking. And so I think one of the things we all can do is be intentional about building relationships with other people, other ethnicities, other cultures, to learn their story, as you said. And I do not want to make this a race thing where it's black and white, but even I, there are certain things that I would like to know that could help me see from the point of view like, oh, I could see that. I understand that. Well, let me tell you why we do this, or let me tell you why we say certain things like this. And I think when you have those intentional conversations, you build a relationship to have empathetic understanding.
That's good.
Really good. We'll kind of wrap things up. I'm going to give you guys just a chance if you want to make just some closing comments. But I just want to say again, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for having me.
You know, you thank us, but I mean, for you to come to our church here in Soddy Daisy, I know that maybe it wasn't hard for you, but for some African Americans, it has been very difficult. And I really want to say thank you for doing that and appreciate what you have shared. And but just maybe, y'all have any other like closing thoughts before we kind of close up?
For me, I just want to thank you guys for taking the time. Like you said, you thanked me, but I think what you've done for me, I don't know what I've done for you, but what you've done for me is you've given me a voice. You've given me the ability to speak to a group of individuals who I probably wouldn't speak to or wouldn't speak to me per se in a normal day throughout the Walmart, just walking past one another. And so now I've been able to speak my truth and share my heart with the hopes that what they heard will maybe just begin to get their wheels turning, just begin to soften maybe some hardened places that may have been in their hearts, some prejudgments that they may have had or grew up with. So thank you for allowing me to express myself and just showing your Christian hearts in doing this. So I appreciate that.
Yeah, I just to echo what Mickey said, thank you. You've been... every time I've asked you to share, you've been so willing. I remember asking you one time, do you get tired of having this conversation? And you said, no, I don't. As long as people are willing to have this conversation, I'm grateful to have it. And so I'm just grateful to you and your friendship. And so thank you, Jermichael.
Absolutely. Thank you, Zach.
Well, we want to thank you for tuning in today. And again, we know one thing. We know that God's call is for us to be one people. And so taking steps like this, we feel like are healthy steps for us to do that. And so we just pray that you would, you know, as a church, that we would understand God's heart for us to love other people, no matter the race or culture, whatever, that God's called us to love one another. Thank you so much again for joining us. And again, if you have any needs, please reach out to the staff. We're here for you, and we love you. Thank you so much.